Hello to all our viewers. Thank you once again for joining us for this session of Nutrition Nectar. Welcome to everybody across the globe who's watching us today on this very interesting session of olive oil. The two experts with me today are Mrs. Ritika Samadar and Mrs. Neeti Jaipuria. We will begin with an interactive session with Ritika, followed by recipes which will be shown by Neeti. And finally, we will answer viewers' questions. Please type your questions in the chat box. This is not a certification program, so please do not expect certificates at the end. And if you have any topic suggestions or future sessions, please do feel free to either write in the chat box or send me an email. My email address is sheelakrishnaswamy@gmail.com, my full name at gmail.com. I'm going to quickly share a disclaimer slide with you. So please give me a moment. Can you all see this?
No, not as yet.
Has it streamed now?
No, Sheila, not as yet.
Okay, I will just read it out to you. The views expressed in this program are for information only. Kindly seek a physician's help if you have a medical problem. Please consult a qualified dietitian for personalized diet plans. So that was the disclaimer for me. I'm going to introduce, were you able to see that slide?
No.
Okay. Sorry about that. So I guess I will just cancel the share and just read out Ritika's introduction. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Ritika Samadar, who, with an extensive experience in the field of nutrition and dietetics spanning more than 25 years, she is a registered dietitian and is presently the regional head of dietetics at Max Healthcare. She is a certified sports nutritionist from International Sports Science Association, California. She is a trained bariatric nutritionist from Herman Memorial Hospital in Houston, USA. She's a master trainer of multidisciplinary diabetes care education program for Project Hope. She's a member of the PFA committee for standardizing diets for hospitals. She was a member, rather, from January 2006 to June 2006. She was awarded the Certificate of Appreciation for the contribution in the field of dietetics by Lady Irwin College in November 2007 and Max Healthcare for delivering outstanding service in December 2008. That's wonderful, Ritika. Congratulations on both your awards. She's an advisory board member to the Nutrition Quotient, and she's also a member of the advisory board under FICCI's Center for Nutrition Excellence. She is a member of the following association. She's a joint secretary of the Delhi chapter of the Indian Dietetic Association. She is the regional officer of IAPEN South Delhi chapter. She is also the chapter representative for IAPEN GNP Delhi. She's an integrated health member of IFSO and a life member of Aussie. And personally, I have known Ritika for some years now, and I know she's a very accomplished dietitian. We've worked on a couple of projects together, and it's wonderful having known you, Ritika, till now. And thank you for coming on this show. Let me begin by asking the questions. Now, a lot of people are eagerly waiting to hear about olive oil, because I think a lot of people would love to use olive oil, but probably are not aware of, you know, which type of olive oil to use and what are the health benefits and so on. So my first question to you is, perhaps you're the only Indian dietitian who has been invited by the Spanish embassy for an in-depth study of olives and olive oil. Can you briefly tell us what led to this unique opportunity? Because I don't know of anybody else who has done this.
So first and foremost, a very good evening to you, ma'am. It's a great pleasure and an honor. And let me tell you, I've been hearing your shows and it is so exciting and fun loving. And there is obviously at the end of the show, there's also a lot of learning. I was very, very excited to be in the show. And finally, I'm here. So that's really nice. And so thank you so much for having me here. Now, coming to Olive, also, you know, the coincidence when you told me, and I actually recall that when was the last time when I visited Spain, it's exactly 10 years. So it's actually a decade. So I was in Spain in 2010 in the month of September, and here we are in 2020. So it's been almost a decade. So, but yes, the memories are still very fresh, and I had a lovely experience over there. And again, while I was working with one of the projects in Delhi with Borges, that's the time I got a little interested in olive oil. And I was introduced to the Spanish embassy, the ministers over there. And there I met who's become a very, very dear friend of mine, Teresa Solves. She was the industry minister who was posted in Delhi that time. And that's how the story began. And during our discussions, you know, we as Indians had very, very little knowledge about what olive oil is, what's the nutritional content, etc. And that's the time they told me, why don't you come for a short vacation with us? It will be an educational trip. And that's how I went to Spain in 2010. And yes, it was actually a training which happened on the farms. So it was very, very practical, and we had a lot of fun, but again, got to know a lot of things which probably we really didn't know as Indians sitting over here about what are olives, how are they grown, and how is the oil extracted, and what are the beneficial components which are there. And I'm sure during our conversation, I'll be able to share a lot of information with you all. And hopefully that will benefit the Indians, especially the dietitians, because still a lot of information which is there over here is completely wrong. And, you know, when we are talking, we are passing the same information to our patients. I feel that, you know, interactions like this would really help us to enlighten the population in general.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Thank you, Ritika. So can you tell us how your overall experience in Spain was, and which parts of Spain have you visited? Because Spain is a beautiful country, and I'm sure there's plenty to see in Spain. So yes, as a part of this project, where did you visit, and which part of Spain did you
again study? So again, first, of course, I was in Madrid, and that's the place where I actually visited the International Olive Council, which is IOC, which is the only registered international organization which is under the United Nations. And that is where you get the most authentic information, any kind of research or information, whether we're talking about olives or olive oil, that is the place where we should actually go in to get the information. So that's the first office which I went. And of course, from there, our actual trip was to Seville, which is a small town in on the outskirts of Madrid, about 3 hours trip from Madrid. And that is where we actually, and of course, it's a beautiful town where I think it's one of the richest cities, they say, in Spain, because you generally have most of the retired people staying there, and everybody has a farm, and everybody is doing olive, they're growing olives in their own farms. And I'm sure, things would have changed now that it's been 10 years. But when I visited Sevilla that time, it was, as I said, each house had a huge farm and they used to grow olives there. And in fact, the extraction of the olive were actually happening at their backyard. So that was something which was so interesting. And what we actually get to know as the extra virgin olive oil is something which was not even being made in the industries or the factories, but were actually manufactured at, everybody's house. And, they used to just consume it. And in fact, that's how even they used to sell it to the cities and all. So that's how, I got to see how the production of the crude, the virgin olive oil happens. And then, of course, we also visited the certain factories to see how the oil is actually being extracted and then being, of course, sent all across the world.
Wow, sounds interesting and actually quite inviting to go to Spain, I think. I'm sure a lot of us would love to go there. Yes, Neeti, I think all of us should go there, make a trip together. All right. Ritika, next question to you is, do olive trees grow only in the Mediterranean region? Do they need any special climatic conditions to grow?
So, I have some slides, and I think that will make it more interesting. So I will just share the slide while I speak, and just give me a minute. Yeah.
Meanwhile, there is a comment already in the beginning of the show itself saying that looking forward to another good session and awesome recipes by Susan Varghese. Thank you so much, Susan, for that.
Pankaj? Just a minute. I think something wrong with the slides, I think. So I think we are not able to share the slides. There's something wrong.
Shall I try sharing it from my end, Ritika?
Yeah, you can, ma'am. Just a minute. I've just called them. Can you see it now?
No. Not as yet.
Not yet.
Just a minute. Yeah. Can you see it now?
No.
No, not as yet, Ritika.
Yeah, it's coming. It's coming to the stream now.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Okay.
Yes.
So yes, mainly I would say almost about 60 to 70% of the entire olives are grown in the Mediterranean coast, and 98% of the entire production of the oil actually happens in these Mediterranean countries, which is basically your Greece, Italy, Spain, Turkey, Morocco, and Tunisia. Very, very interesting to see was there was these farms of olives, which you see, and incidentally, these trees grow for almost thousands of years. And in fact, the first 7 years, they're more like infants where there's no production and you have very small fruits which just fade away. But it's only after the seventh year that you can actually start picking the fruits and start using them as either olives or olive oils. And the production keeps on happening for almost 150 years. So the longevity of a particular tree giving the fruits for almost about 150 years, in fact, 140, 45 years. That's a huge, and each tree every year yields about 20 to 30 kilos of olives. So it was actually amazing to see, the rows of olive trees and of course the production of that. And then of course, we're going to talk about that, how the olives are being plucked and how do they segregate it and how is it sent to the factories and of course to the places where they can actually press it and the oils are being taken out. So that's of course about where the olives are growing. And the other thing which is very interesting about olives is, so I'm sure all of us know that olives is actually a fruit and it's a drupe. So basically what it means is that, it has one seed, a solid seed, and it has a pulp, which is basically the fruit, and it has a skin. And I would say something like, you have the other drupe, which would be your apricot, which is another one, or you can have your prunes, which is also a drupe. And the basic difference is on the amount of sugar content in the oil, which is present in these fruits. So as you can see, when we talk about an olive fruit, the percentage of sugar is very, very less. It's about 2 to almost 5-6%. But yes, it has a high amount of fat present, which is almost about 30% in good qualities of olive. So that is where the fruit, actually, it's one of the only fruits, I think, which actually give you oil. In all the other case, whether we're talking about sunflower or we're talking about cotton seeds or we're talking about corns and all, most of the time, it's the seed or the flower seed, which gives you the oil. Very rarely do you have a fruit giving you the oil. So that's where the olives are a little different from all the other oils, the edible oils, which we usually talk about.
Okay, that's very interesting to know. So we've seen green olives and black olives in the market. Is there any difference, apart from the color, of course, is there any difference between the two? And there's a request from Madhu Sharma. She says, Ritika, can you go on to the slideshow? Are you on slideshow, Ritika?
I think so. I'm on the slideshow, but I think we tried it earlier also, but I think somehow we don't manage.
It's okay. Madhu. I think, the PowerPoint show presentation mode is for some reason not showing. So I guess we'll have to make do with whatever PowerPoint is being visible now. Yeah, please continue, Ritika.
Yeah, so very interesting. Again, there are almost about, when you actually ask them, when I asked these people, they told me there are almost about 23, 24 varieties of olives which are present. But the main difference is only in the colors and the shades of the olives. And of course, the most two common types, which again, we find it in India also, is of course the green and the ripe one, or what we call the black olives. The difference between very, very clear, one is, of course, the time when the olives are being harvested. So that's one of the criteria to determine whether it will be a green olive or it will be a ripe or a black olive. So the harvesting, in fact, starts from the month of September and almost carries on till about December, till about February. And in the initial time when they're actually handpicked, the fresh, just before the ripening starts, that's the time when you pick up these olives from the tree. They are the pure green olives, and they are the ones which are absolutely, you know, very hard in shape, very firm in shape, I would say. And they are also very bitter in taste, and that's because they have the highest quantity of the antioxidants. And when these are being plucked, they are actually put into the brine solution because they're so bitter that you will not be able to have even a bite of it. So once they're put into the brine solution and a certain amount of processing being done, then it is actually being transported for probably for the public. So that's your green olive, and they are the healthiest one, though the oil content would be slightly less as compared to the completely ripe or the middle one, which we call them. Now, coming to the other extreme of the olives is, of course, the black or the darkish purple one, which we usually get to see in the market. Now, they are the ones which are being plucked usually at the end of the harvesting session, which is usually by December or January. And this is the time where, of course, the trees are completely full of these olives, usually dark colored. And you usually use a machine to, you know, just pluck, pluck all these olives into your baskets. So initially we were doing it handpicked when they were raw, but now we are usually doing it. And then they have to be separated because obviously there's a lot of damaging of the fruits happen. And the ones which remain firm in the shape, but of course the color is completely different. It is purplish or black in color. And of course they are much more fruity or sweet in taste now. And that's because the antioxidant content has come down. And also the basic antioxidant, which is your allopurinol, which is the main antioxidant which is present in your olives. The percentage of that is comparatively a little less, but this is the one which is usually taken for, to be eaten as fruit, like an olives which people usually have. So these are the two distinct varieties. But again, in between, you know, from every month they pluck in, it will be from a dark green to a yellow to a light purplish to, of course, your dark black or a purple color. So that is basically more to do with the time of the harvesting and of course the ripening of the fruit, which gives it its color.
Okay, that's really interesting because all the time I thought it was just a color difference. Didn't know about the difference in antioxidant levels and the fat levels and all of that. That's really great. And I didn't know that also olives were very bitter to begin with, and that's the reason you say they put in brine. Very interesting information. So are all these olives grown organically, or are any fertilizers and chemicals used to grow them?
Yeah. So yeah, again, now, of course, it's now become more like a industry, and it's a huge industry in Spain and Italy. So, of course, now no longer we have only the organically grown olives. But as I said, you go to small towns and you go to small villages there in Spain, every household grows their own olives. And of course, they are also selling or importing a certain amount, exporting a certain amount. So, yes, the ones which I saw was completely organic. But of course, once the ones which are being actually exported and are made in huge amounts would definitely be in use, will be using a lot of these fertilizers, etc.
I must say, lucky for you, Ritika, you got the best of everything during your visit.
Yes.
All right. Coming to the next question now, let's move on to olive oil, because I'm sure people are waiting to hear about olive oil. We see so many types of olive oil in the market. What's the difference between the all these varieties?
So, it's very, very interesting. So this is a picture where we had taken long time back, almost 10 years back. And as you can see that, you can actually go onto the farms and just keep on plucking your olives, and you have these big jars.
Yeah, sorry to interrupt, Ritika, the slides have not moved. You're still in the first slide.
Is it? Yeah. Are they moving?
No, they're not.
Are they moving now?
No, not yet, but it's okay. Please carry on.
So this is, of course, we had gone to the farm and where you can actually pluck it. But so again, just a minute, because I had a very nice, just a minute. Sharing.
All right, while you're getting your slides, I'm going to show Madhu Sharma's. Thank you, Madhu, for saying that. In for another very fascinating topic to hear Ritika from Ritika firsthand. So looks like.
Can we see the this thing right now? Is the slide showing?
No. So people are very happy to hear firsthand from a person who has been to Spain and experienced the entire olive oil experience.
So.
Okay, questions are coming in already, but we will take I'm telling the viewers, we will take the questions at the end of the session. So please feel free to send them meanwhile, but we definitely will answer your questions after the discussion, followed by the recipes using olive oil, and then we come to the questions. Thank you very much for your patience. Yeah.
So anyway, I think we can go ahead because I don't think so. I can show the slides, but
okay. Should I try?
So anyway, when I went to Sevilla, which I said is a small town, so there of course the production was in a very very what I would say a crude manner, because as I said, everybody had their own production of the extra virgin olive oil at their own farm. So the process is actually when they pluck the olives. Either they are, you know, if they have to be taken as fruit, then of course they have to be, you know, put into the brine solution and the process is completely different. But in case if the oil production has to be done, it is very, very important that the moment they pluck the olives, it has to be immediately transported to the crushing and the pressing machine, which is again there in their own farms. So again, a very crude machine wherein, you know, the first process is they just take the olives, they wash it properly. That is very, very important because obviously there are a lot of leaves and the dirt which is there. So it is just washed under, under the running water. And then, of course, the process of the pressing starts off, which is again, you know, initially the method which I saw was, of course, a normal, you know, the grill or the what we saw, you know, the way we use our stones at home to, you know, grind our what we say your idli mixtures and the dosa mixtures. So it was actually like that, a typical stone which was there. But now, of course, when you go to the industries and all, it is a very different one which we see it. So is the screen now visible?
Yeah, are you able to see the screen?
No, but it's not.
We have one slide.
Yeah, no, but I think it's got stuck. No, it's got stuck again. So then of course, once it's been pressed, then the first oil which comes out after crushing these fresh olives is what is called the extra virgin olive oil. And that is what is actually being put into big decanters. And the first layer of oil which comes out is, of course, your extra virgin olive oil. And that is as simple as that. So over a period of overnight in the morning when they come back, the oil which is being separated, the first layer with just the first crushing is your extra virgin olive oil. It uses simple mechanical processes, does not use any kind of heat temperature. And we need to understand that when we talk about an extra virgin olive oil, the main differentiator is that you're using just mechanical processing. You're not using any kind of thermal processing. And the temperature of crushing, the temperature at which they reach while crushing the fruit is maximum to 27 degrees centigrade and not more than that. So a lot of time it is also called the cold pressed olive oil, which also means an extra virgin olive oil. Now, once this layer of oil is taken out, of course, the next layer would definitely be your virgin olive oil and the pure olive oil, which again has the same amount of antioxidant, does not require very high thermal temperature, and can be done even at a household level. And the other one is, of course, the crush or the solute which remains back, which is actually like a pulp, a greenish pulp. Now, this is what is actually being sent to the industries or the factories. So it was very, very interesting to see that once the extra virgin olive oil has been taken out, the entire pulp is actually put into a container and is being transported to the factories and industries. And that is where the final refining of the oil happens. And of course, there is a lot of thermal high temperature being used and all the chemicals being used. And then the oil which is extracted from there is called the crude pomace olive oil. So that is how it is completely different when we talk about an olive oil, which is an extra virgin or a virgin olive oil, vis-a-vis when we are talking about a crude pomace olive oil. And again, we will talk about the nutritional value as we go ahead, but they are completely two different types of oil in terms of the nutrition values.
Okay, that's wonderful. It's so interesting. I just wanted to ask if you can see the slide that I'm sharing. Is it visible?
Yes, olive oil production. We can see that.
Okay, great. So, Ritika, I'll move the slides for you here. You will have to tell me when to go to the next slide. When you come.
So, you can move to the next one now. So, this is how the crude one, which I showed, this is the crude one, which was happening at the household level. The next one. Uh-huh. The next one. Yeah. So this is how in the industry when it happens. So the olives are taken off. So can you go back to the previous one, please, ma'am?
Yeah.
So the first line which you see is where the milling and the pressing is happening. That is happening at the home or the farms, which is very crude. And of course, the oil which comes out is, of course, your extra virgin olive oil. Once and then the whatever is the pulp which is left over is the one which actually goes to the refineries or what we know as the industries and the factories, and that is where the processing, both in terms of the thermal as well as, you know, high temperature or the various chemicals which is being used, and the final extraction is of course the pomace or the olive oil which we know it. So of course, as I said, the composition is very, very different. Ma'am, can you move to the next slide? So therefore, when we are actually talked about, when you're asking me that how do I distinguish between the different olive oils, or are there different olive oils? So there are basically two categories by which you can actually differentiate between the olive oils which are present. One is, of course, the chemical characteristics, which basically looks into the acidity level and the in terms of the sterols or what we call the antioxidants present in them. And the second is, of course, the organoleptic characteristic, which is, of course, the smell. So that is, of course, very, very distinct. And I still remember the place where we had stayed, the gentleman, whose farmhouse where we were staying, he actually told me, you know, he made me smell different bottles. And he, of course, I could not make much of a difference, but he was very, very clear on the one which is completely an extra virgin olive oil, to the one which is a virgin olive oil, to one which probably had been there for some time and because of which the antioxidant levels had come down. So the organoleptic sensory characteristic is something which is very, very important, especially for Spanish people, because that is how they actually can come to know whether it's a pure oil or whether it is what we call the refined olive oil.
Okay, wonderful. Is it true that extra virgin olive oil is not meant for cooking, and only virgin olive oil and pomace can be used for cooking? Because I think in India, we're very confused about what olive oil to use when.
Absolutely.
So, ma'am, can you go to the next slide?
Sure. Yes.
So again, if I see into the Indian perspective, again, there are about 7 or 8 varieties of olive oil which are present across the globe. But when we talk about the Indians and the oils which are available in India, we basically have 3 types of olive oil which are available. So one is, of course, your extra virgin olive oil. We've just spoken about it. Now, this is the highest quality. And of course, it is quite fruity in taste. And the acidity level, that means the amount of the free fatty acids which is present, should not exceed 0.8%. So that is how it can be differentiated as compared to the other oils. The next is, of course, the virgin oil, which is again almost the same quality as, and again, we know it by the pure olive oil, which is available in India. And again, the in terms of the smell or the fruity taste would be little less as compared to the extra virgin, and the acidity level must not exceed 2%. That means the free fatty acid level should not be more than 2%. The pomace, my concern is, of course, the olive pomace oil, which is freely available. And I generally tell my clients and my patient, whenever you're getting into a market and they tell you one with one free, I'm sure you're getting your pomace oil. So that is where you have to be a little careful, because as I just explained, the residual paste which is actually obtained after taking out the extra virgin and the virgin oil, the paste is then sent into the factory, and that is where the olive oil, the oil which is finally extracted, is there. So there's nothing wrong in having the pomace oil. It is not poisonous or it is not causing any harm. But remember, you're not getting the benefits of the extra virgin oil, which is, of course, the polyphenols, the various antioxidants, and, of course, the high amounts of MUFA content, which is there, right? So, ma'am, can you go to the next slide?
Yes. That's done.
Yeah. So I think we've already talked about this. Yeah, ma'am. Next one.
Next one. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's what. So we've already talked about the pomace oil, and hence, so obviously it diminishes the health benefits which are there in the normal olive oils, right? The next one, ma'am. So this is a very nice, again, I picked it up from the IOC site. And again, this is basically an advertisement which they show it for all their consumers in Spain, how to differentiate between an extra virgin vis-a-vis the regular olive oil, which is also available freely in the Spain markets. And as I said, the difference are very, very, this is completely natural. This is a chemically refined. And of course, the various benefits which you're getting in olive oil, you would not get it in the regular olive oil. But that doesn't mean that the regular olive oil is causing any ill health. So it's like a normal refined vegetable oil, which we are using, but we are not getting the benefits of the extra virgin olive oil, which is, of course, why people usually go for olive oils.
Okay, that's interesting. So is there a vast difference between olive oil and, you know, the regular oils that most of us use in India?
So when we talk about now coming to the nutritional, I think, can you move to the next slide? Yeah. So this is the nutritional value of olive oil. So I think all oils, I think we all know that obviously is 100% fat for sure. There are no other carbohydrates and proteins, etc. Now, when we talk about the fat component, we are basically interested in to know the percentage of the saturated to the PUFA to the MUFA content. Now, which oil is or which type of fatty acid is important for us? So one is, of course, to have a good MUFA content, which is, of course, heart friendly, good for diabetes and all the other kinds of chronic disorders and the problems which we have. So they have very, very protective effects, which you're going to talk about. The second important thing, which is very important nowadays, is to make sure that whenever you're taking a PUFA rich oil, or if there is a certain amount of PUFA which is present in the oil, the percentage of the omega 3 to the omega 6 is very, very important. The ideal requirement for omega 6 to the omega 3 ratio should be between 5:1 to about 10:1. This is what the ideal recommendation are. Most of the refined oil which we are having, the PUFA, that is the omega 6 to the omega 3 ratio, is as high as 20:1 or 30:1. And that is where we really need to, when we talk about the type of oil, it is not only talking about the total amount of PUFA to the MUFA, but also going a step below to find out the percentage of the omega 3 versus your omega 6, and of course the MUFA. So now coming to olive oil, one, of course, we all know it's the highest in the MUFA content. That is your monounsaturated fatty acids. If you compare with the other oils, like, you know, you have canola oil or you have peanut oils or we have mustard oil, they also have a high amount of MUFA, but that would be somewhere ranging between about 50 to 60 to about 65%. So MUFA content is the highest when we talk about olive oil. The second is, though the PUFA content is less in olive oil as compared to the other, it is just about 11 grams in 100 grams, but the percentage of omega 6 to omega 3 is 8:1, which is in fact an ideal ratio, because we want to have more of omega 3 in our diets. So that is where the olive oil is something which we really need to talk about when we talk about the health benefits of olive oil. The second, of course, I spoke about the various the polyphenols and the antioxidants. So two of the antioxidants is, of course, your vitamin E and vitamin K. And very interesting to understand is that if you're taking about almost about, you know, 100 ml, which is, of course, too much for a day's consumption. But, you know, as you know, for people in Spain, even the fruit which they have, you know, even if you go to any restaurants or tables or even at their home, the first thing which is offered is an olive, right? So as a fruit. And then, of course, the olive oils are kept there and you can just put it on your slice of bread and just have that, right? So, of course, the consumption is very high. So it almost meets about 90. So the Indian RDA for your vitamin E is almost about, I think it's about 19 or 20 milligrams. And you almost meet about 14, it's about 15 or 16 milligrams. And this is about 14 milligrams from 100 ml. Similarly, the vitamin K, very high, it's about 60 micrograms, which is almost your 50% of your RDA. So these are the two antioxidants which are available in very high amounts. But remember, this would only be there in your extra virgin and the virgin olive oil. The moment it undergoes a processing and a thermal, the percentage would be much, much less. And similarly, when we talk about your phytoestrol, they are the maximum in the green fresh olives, which we first spoke about. And the moment it starts getting processing or the moment the fruit starts getting ripened, the percentage of the phytoestrol will definitely come down. So this, of course, the amount which I've mentioned is from the olives which have been picked up just before ripening, and they're absolutely green in color, and the percentage of your the phytoestrol is the highest in them. And so it's not only about the MUFA, which I think all of us knew for very long that olive oils are the richest in MUFA, but the other components which have been not talked about. So your antioxidants and the polyphenols and the esterols are very, very key component of your extra virgin and the virgin olive oils.
Okay, that was very interesting, especially the health benefits and, you know, the nutrition profile that you've shared with the viewers. I think this is very, very informative and very interesting. Thank you for that. So I think what you're saying is there is no Indian equivalent to olive oil. Is that right? Because looking at the fat ratio and everything is and the vitamin E and vitamin K content and even the phytosterols, I think, probably.
The one which I would say is nearest to, of course, yes. Yeah. So all of us can't afford olive oil for sure. Right. So the ones which are nearest to that is, of course, your mustard oil. So peanut oil, though, has a high amount of MUFA, but the doesn't have omega-3 at all. So that is where it lacks, right? So we have canola oil, which is quite close to olive oil. And then we have your mustard oil, which is very close. Mm-hmm. The Indian oil, mustard oil is very close. And also your rice bran oil, which is somewhere quite close to olive oil, though the percentage of MUFA is less, but the amount of omega-3 to omega-6 ratio is much better. So I would say these are the two oils which are somewhere close to your olive oils for sure.
Okay, that's nice to know, because as you rightly said, not many people can, in India especially, can afford to use olive oil on a daily basis. So it's good to know that, you know, at least some of the oils have a similar nutritional profile as olive oil. So before we end, do you have any more slides to share, Ritika?
Ma'am, you can just go on to the next one.
Here it is.
So again, one of the things I think you had asked me, that can it be used for cooking? So yes. The smoking point of the extra virgin olive oil is about 210 degrees, which is slightly higher when you're talking about deep frying your food. So we usually use about 180 to 200 degree as a heating, as a deep frying. But again, to understand that when we talk about the Indian deep frying, the oil keeps on, you know, you keep on using the same oil over and over again. So you're reheating the oil. Second, when we are frying our pakoras and all, we always, it's not once, but all the time, we overshoot the smoking point because, you know, the flame being high, etc. So I would still say, though, if you see the literature, if you go to the site of IOC and all, it does say that it has a high smoking point, which is 210. So it can be used for frying. But when it comes to the Indian situation, the kind of frying we do, so our pakoda. So when I talk about frying, it's not my cooking of vegetables and all, but I'm talking about my deep frying of my pakoras and my and my chips, etc. I would really say that extra virgin olive oil should not be used. Also, very interesting thing to understand about olive oil, because of the very high MUFA content in that, it does not get oxidized very fast. So it's not that if you are deep frying it, probably the oil is getting oxidized and all. It's not that. One, the thing is that you're losing out on the the all the antioxidants, so they get lost. So that's one thing. And the second is the extra virgin olive oil has a very strong smell, or what we call the fruity tinge or the bitterness, which I think does not go with the Indian palate too much, especially when we are talking about pakoras and chips, etc. So yes, it is ideal. You can use it for your normal cooking. You can use it for your continental dishes, etc. I was surprised, like the place where we were staying, they obviously used only extra virgin, and they were using it for everything. Even for their baking, they were using the extra virgin olive oil. And for the simple reason, when I asked them, the answer was that because of the high MUFA content, it does not get oxidized very easily. So you can use it for temperature beyond that. But again, as I said, for Indian conditions, I would just say that if you're using the pure olive oil for fryings, etc., it's perfectly oil. The extra virgin olive oil, for its taste and the and for the texture which it has, I think it goes best, and I'm sure we have an expert, Neeti, would be able to tell us more about it. It goes best with the continental, the sauté vegetables, and of course, just drinking it like that. You know, that's how I saw it in Spain all the time.
Oh God, okay. Should I move on to the next slide? Yeah.
I think I'm more or less done with. So this is of course a review paper. I thought there'll be a lot of dietitians over here. So I would really request all of you who are really interested to know about olive oils and the research which have been done on humans. So this is a review paper which was published, and of course, by the IOC in 2018, and talks about the various human researches which have been done on seeing the benefits of olive oil on various diseases, the cardiovascular, the degenerative diseases, cancer prevention, weight and diabetes. So this is a beautiful review paper, and I would really love all of you to read it, because that will actually tell you that it's not about the nutritional profile which we talk about, but its impact on the various chronic lifestyle diseases it has on. So it's a lovely paper, and I would really request all of you to go through this review paper. So that's it, I think, ma'am.
Okay, so it looks like this was the last slide, so I'm going to stop sharing now.
Yeah.
And come back to let me just close my presentation and come back. Yeah. Okay, so that was wonderful. Before we end, Ritika, one last question to you is, how do the Spaniards use olive oil? You did say they drizzle it on bread and use it for everything. So, I mean, do they use anything else at all, or is it only olive oil always?
So, yes, so it's very interesting, you know, even in the roadside and it's so expensive, you know, so even in the roadside, or if you go to any house or to a restaurant, on the tables, you have the extra virgin olive oil, you will always find a bread or a toast. Mm-hmm. And of course, you have the fresh olives present. So you start there, and it's absolutely free, right? So everybody drizzles it. So the best way is, of course, to put it on your toast. Drizzle your olive oils, and of course with a pinch of black pepper, and it really tastes really nice. But yes, there's a lot of salads which they eat, the Mediterranean salads it's famous for, wherein they use both the olive oil and the olives. And that is where I saw the uses of different colored olives which we talked about. So that's one way. And of course, the guacamole, which we have, the avocado paste, which they use to make it more soft. And that's how I got to know over there, that they use extra virgin olive oil, and that makes it much more softer in texture. And we don't use it over here, but over there, that's the way they use it. So I think, and of course, anything and everything, there was only olive oil available. So I think every food we ate, the olives.
Okay, that was excellent knowledge on olives and olive oil. Ritika, thank you so much. You're already getting a lot of thank yous and praises in the chat box. So thank you so much for sharing all this information. Now let's move on to the recipes, and let's see if Neeti has fried any pakoras using olive oil. Yeah.
Oh no, I haven't.
Okay. So I'm just going to quickly introduce Neeti. She is a creative chef and partner of Gumdrops in Bangalore. She's an amazing cook, treating her family and friends to awesome dishes, and I have tasted them many times, and she's really, really good. She turned her passion into entrepreneurship. She caters for parties and other occasions. Her snacks, desserts, and mouth fresheners, digestives are made freshly at home from scratch. She does not use any preservatives and additives and all of that. So over to you, Neeti, to your lovely recipes. And I can see a lot of people are waiting for them.
Thank you, Sheila and Ritika. It was really, really informative. There were so many things which I didn't know, really. So very enlightening session today. Thank you so much for sharing so much of knowledge with us. And now give me a moment. I'll just share my screen. Before going forward, I want you all to just have one look at the tray that I've done today. Just give me a moment so that you can have a look totally. So there's a soup, there's a veggie and rice, brown rice, and there's a salad. And I've made homemade vinaigrette. So I'll share the recipe which I've used in the salad.
Oh, wow. Looks delicious. And very colorful too.
Yeah, so just give me a moment, please. Okay, so what I've taken today is firstly a rustic olive and tomato, fresh tomato soup.
Niti, can you please put the slides on slideshow, presentation mode?
Yeah, presentation mode, Munna. Just give me a moment, Sheila.
Sure. I click on the first, the topmost one, the first slide.
Yeah, 1 minute, 1 minute.
Okay. Okay, no problem. Meanwhile, let's start taking the questions. Let's see what... I think Divya Lunawat says, hello, ma'am, can you please address how heating affects olive oil? Ritika, I think you've answered this already. Would you like to say something else on this?
Yeah, so the only thing is, of course, the moment you're heating, so one is, of course, we know that the, you know, there is an oxidation of the oils which happen, but that happens more when we're talking about the PUFA and the saturated fat. The MUFAs are much better reserved in terms of oxidation. But as I said, when we talk about olive oil and heating, we are basically losing out on the various antioxidants. So we're losing out on the vitamin E's and the K's, which is there in plenty, and also the polyphenols and the sterols. So when you're heating the oil for too long, especially olive oil, you would be losing out on all the antioxidants and the polyphenols. But when you're heating about, when you're talking about the other oils, we are basically losing, we are actually getting them converted into trans fats because of the oxidation which happens in the oil on heating.
Okay, thank you, Ritika. Yeah. Okay, slides are beautifully visible, Niti.
Yes.
Yeah, so what we have today here for you all is an olive oil fresh tomato soup, a vinaigrette dressed salad, braised vegetables in olive oil with brown rice, seasoned brown rice with garlic. So coming to the first recipe, what I present you today is rustic olive and fresh tomato soup. Here I've taken about 6 to 8 tomatoes. This soup is good for 2 people. 3 to 4 crushed garlic, 1 bay leaf, 2 cloves, 1 small piece of grated ginger, and 5 to 7 fresh basil leaves, 3 to 4 thinly sliced black olives, but now I would say green olives, as Ritika has told, 1 teaspoon of olive oil and salt and pepper to taste. So these are the ingredients. The method to do is we wash the tomatoes well and you make slits on the tomato skin with a sharp knife. Then you take a pan of boiling water and immerse these tomatoes and just boil them for about 5 minutes. Turn off the flame and remove these tomatoes from the water and retain this water. Do not dispose this water. Allow the tomatoes to cool and then de-skin this. The skin of the tomato, because of boiling, comes out very efficiently. Then just chop it roughly and keep it aside. Then in a pan, you take olive oil. I have used extra virgin oil in all my cooking today. And so just take a teaspoon of olive oil, add the crushed garlic and saute. Then you add the bay leaves, the cloves, and saute it again for a minute or so. Now you add the chopped tomatoes and cook them for about 5 minutes. Add the saved water that you had kept it aside, a little bit of it. Turn off the flame, cool it completely. Now, either in a mixer jar or with a blender, you puree this entire mixture, sieve it in a pan, add the kept water which you had kept aside, all the of it, and add the salt and pepper and garnish it with basil leaves and sliced olives. and give it a good boil for 2-3 minutes and serve it hot. This can also be served with croutons or garlic bread, which can be drizzled with olive oil. Coming to the next one is the vinaigrette dressed salad. It's a very easy salad. One thing I would like to emphasize, like I always do, please use ingredients that are very readily available at your home. Do not run for any ingredient which is to the supermarket. Whatever you have at home, please use those. Here today I have used 6 to 8 cherry tomatoes. I have diced a small medium cucumber, an apple which is cored and diced, a medium-sized capsicum which is diced, a few dollops of feta cheese which is optional. And I have made homemade vinaigrette. It is very easy to make. It's just a teaspoon of balsamic vinegar, or you can use any other vinegar which is handy, 2 teaspoons of extra virgin oil and a few drops of lemon juice. To this, you can also add little honey and salt and pepper to taste. What you do is, in a big bowl, you take all the above ingredients which I have mentioned, except the feta cheese, toss them well and add the vinaigrette in such a way where it forms a uniform coating. Just toss them roughly. Once all the ingredients are well tossed, you can add the feta cheese and serve. And again, this can be served with a slice of multigrain or a rye bread, drizzled with extra virgin oil. Now, for the main course, to this is brown rice. For the vegetables, I've taken, again, this is for two. It serves two people. The ingredients for this is carrots, French beans, capsicum. If you have broccoli at home, cauliflower, peas. I insist again, use all the vegetables that are there at home. Do not rush to the supermarket to get any. And here you can take 2 cloves of crushed garlic, 1/4 teaspoon of chili flakes, which adds a nice spicy tinge to it, 1/4 teaspoon of store-bought chili, sweet chili sauce, and 1 teaspoon of, again, extra virgin oil, salt and pepper to taste. The method to do prepare these vegetables are, in a pan, you take the oil, add the crushed garlic and saute it for about 30 seconds. Then you add all your tender vegetables, which is the carrot, beans and cauliflower. Add 1/4 cup of water, add the salt and allow it to cook on slow flame. Once, when it is slightly tender, add the capsicum, the spinach leaves, and if you have the broccoli, then the broccoli. Stir the vegetables for 1 minute or 2. Then you add your pepper, the chili flakes and the sweet chili sauce. Make sure you do not overcook these vegetables, otherwise it loses the crunchiness. Once tender, you switch off the flame and keep this prepared vegetables aside. Now for the seasoned garlic brown rice, I take 1 cup of basmati brown rice, which is boiled, 4 to 5 cloves of chopped garlic, 2 to 3 teaspoons. 3 whole dry red chili, 1 teaspoon of olive oil. Again, I have used today extra virgin oil, and 1 teaspoon of store-bought garlic sauce. You can use Szechuan or you can use a normal garlic sauce, and of course, salt to taste. Again, this is very easy to prepare. In a wide pan or a kadhai, take 1 teaspoon of oil, add the whole red chili, the chopped garlic, and saute it for about 1 minute or so. Add the teaspoon of the garlic sauce. Then you add your rice and cilantro and the salt and give it a good mix. Now you serve this hot beside the braised vegetables. So coming to the end of it, I would like to now show you my prepared dishes. Just give me a minute. So here we go. Now this is my rustic garlic tomato soup. I have put the olives just to show you all. This is how we put it. I'm just, presentation matters, as you know. So I've just let it here. and it is really, really nice and healthy. I think Ritika will endorse it if it is, with the ingredients. So, and I have made some multigrain croutons, which is drizzled with the, yeah, these are the ones that you can put it inside and have. Again, this is just drizzled with olive oil and just toasted it in the oven. Next is the salad. So this is the salad. I hope it's nicely visible to you.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Because so I have the cherry tomatoes, I have the cucumber, the capsicum, and I had some oranges at home, so I've just sliced that and dressed it with vinaigrette. It's really, really easy to make this vinaigrette at home. It'll be like a suspension. Whenever you make it, you can store it in your refrigerator. So it is just nothing but vinegar and olive oil, extra virgin olive oil, with some salt and pepper and little drops of lime juice. And there's a tip which I can give you, share with you.
Hiti? I think there's been a problem with the Niti's screen. So I guess we'll come back. Yeah, okay, please go ahead. We lost you in between, Niti. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So like I was saying, if you make this vinaigrette and keep it in an empty jam jar, it induces a fruity flavor to the vinaigrette, and it's a very good salad dressing. So that is just a tip. And here are the braised vegetables with the cilantro brown rice. See, like, you don't lose the color or the crunchiness of the vegetables, and the brown rice is very nicely, of course you can't it gives a very, very nice flavor to the rice. So like Ritika was saying, I had an order for a focaccia bread. So it's just got baked and out of the oven. And you were saying how they drizzle extra virgin oil. So this is how we drizzle it and keep it spongy and nice. So you can see the sponge. I don't know whether it's clear. Yeah. So we just baked it. It's just out of the oven. So I thought I'll share this. It's not on the menu, but since we just baked one, so I thought I'll share it with you.
Oh, that's fantastic. Yeah.
So, without knowing too much of the nutrients about the olive oil, but today I've used just the extra virgin oil for all my entire cooking today. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you for sharing all those lovely, yummy recipes as always, Niti. And I know the viewers really look forward to your recipes every session. Now let's move on to the question answer session. There's Mitra Prabhu who's asking, can olive oil be used for frying? I think, Ritika, you've already answered that. And Harleen Bakshi says, thanks a lot, Sheila ma'am and Ritika ma'am, for an amazing topic. So Ritika, many thanks to you for that. Madhu Sharma says, wish I had known this a year ago before visiting Spain. And she would have probably visited some of the oil farms. Okay, maybe another trip, Madhu. Here's a question from Sheila Dange. I'm going to show it here. Can you please compare cold-pressed coconut oil with virgin olive oil? Is there any comparison, Ritika? Let's say coconut oil. You're muted. Ritika, you're muted.
So when we talk about cold press, it is the process by which the oil is extracted. So it means that you're using a temperature which is not more than 30, 35 degrees of centigrade, thereby preserving the nutritive value. Because the moment you heat oil to a very high degree, you're probably oxidizing the fat and losing a certain amount. So it is only the difference in terms of the processing. But when we cannot compare coconut oil with olive oil in terms of the nutritive value, because they're completely different, you know. So coconut oil is 90% and above of saturated and has very less of PUFA, which is about 1 to 2%, if I'm right, and MUFA is about 7-8%. But when you talk about olive oil, it's just the other way around. It's 70%, 70 to 75% of MUFA, and the rest is from the saturated and the PUFA. So nutritive value, it's completely different. But yes, the processing which we're using is cold press, can be used in olive oil, can be used in coconut oil, or can be used in any other refined vegetables.
There's a question from Chandini Swaminathan. Does soaking green olives in brine solution result in decrease in antioxidant content?
Yes. So as I said, when we talk about the fresh green olives, they are very, very bitter. Nobody can just bite it into it, you know, just plucking it from the tree and bite. You cannot do it. It is so bitter. And that's because of the very high amount of antioxidant, oleuropein, which I just talked about. So that is why it is mandatory that you have to soak it in brine, and you do lose a certain amount, but that's perfectly all right. And even when you're talking about extraction of the oils, I did not mention, but the ones which they use, they really don't use the fresh olives because one, they're very hard and the extraction of oil is a little less. The percentage of oil per fruit is a little less. So usually they use the one which is a slightly yellowish in color, wherein the percentage of oil is almost 30%, you know, of the fruit, which is very, very high. So yes, the antioxidant level would be slightly less, but that's perfectly all right. You still have a lot to have from the olives.
Right. So the next question is, what's extra light olive oil? If there's something
so,
like that.
So I'm myself not sure. What we really know is extra virgin, the light or the pure, and then we have the pomace. So when we talk about, so I think what you meant was the extra light or the pure olive oil, which is almost the same as the extra virgin, except that the percentage of the free fatty acid is about 2%, not more than 2%. And it is, and of course, it does not have the typical pungent, fruity smell which is there in the extra virgin oil. So it can be used for your cooking, especially your Indian cooking and all. So, you know, the companies like Bodges and Leonardo's, they've come out with specifically pure olive oil, which is slightly yellowish in color and not the dark green color, which is used for Indian cookings. And then they also have the extra virgin, which is usually available. So again, one thing which I forgot to mention is, of course, you know, you will actually get to see when you buy an olive oil, it'll, extra virgin olive oil, it will always be in a dark colored container because of the high antioxidants. You always have to be very careful where you are preserving it. If you're preserving it in light area or it in a very warm place, you're probably losing out on all the nutrients. So that is why it is always available in those thick green or a dark colored containers so that you are able to preserve the antioxidants in them.
Okay, wonderful. Madhu, again, pomace oil could be more suitable for massages.
Ideally, yes. Ideally, yes.
Okay, so there is still some use. There is still some use for pomace oil. It's not, you know, totally bad. Okay. Is the seed used in any way? Jalaja would like to know. If the seed is used in any way.
Ideally, no, you know, yeah. So ideally, once it's crushed, it completely gets into a mashy form. And then the entire thing is being sent for refining into the industries and the factories. So I really did not get to see any particular use of the seeds in general. So I'm not very sure about it.
Okay. So Jalaja has another question. Can you name some of the antioxidants in olive oil?
Yeah. So one is, of course, the most common is, of course, your oleuropein, which is the main antioxidant, which is basically a phytosterol, which is the major one. The other one, of course, is your vitamin E and the vitamin K. Mm. And besides that, there are almost about 30 polyphenols which have been identified. But again, I did a lot of research to see, actually went into the site to see what is the percentage or what is the amount of the polyphenols, but sadly could not get the amount of the polyphenols which are present in the olives. But it is, yes, it does talk about the amount of vitamin E, the K, and your oleuropein, which is your antioxidant present, but does not talk about the amount of polyphenols which are present in that.
Okay. Gaurapriya, I'm just going to say, you know, put her message here. Great informative talk by Ritika. Thank you once so much, Ritika, for that. And she says,
yeah, the recipes were really interesting. Yeah. The recipes were superb.
Thank you.
Right. So, okay, there's one more question. These days, olive oil has become cheap. So how do we know if it's really genuine or not?
No, so again, you know, if you go to the IOC site, there are certain, so they have a very informative site on labeling of olive oils, right? And it is actually mandatory, especially when they're exporting it. So every information has to be there. So first and foremost, the pomace oil is not edible as per the European Union and as per the IOC, right? It's only coming here. So you will not probably find much information on the pomace olive oil. But whenever you're picking up an extra virgin or a pure olive oil, it will have the basic information with regards to the amount of MUFA and the amount of the presence of the antioxidants presence, which is mandatory. So again, the one which we're talking about, the edible olive oil, is of course the extra virgin and the pure, and you would find it on the labels for sure.
Okay, wonderful. Molly Joshi, thank you, Molly, for attending. You've been an ardent follower of Nutrition Nectar. So she says it was a very informative session. Thank you, Molly. And thanks to Neeti and Ritika, of course, for making it very informative. There's one more person, Suvarna Dumde, saying very informative. Very informative session, Ritika ma'am. Prachi Jain, thank you all for saying all these lovely words. Okay. Sorry, I think, yeah, which olive oil can be used for skin? I think we need to have a session on skin. There are so many skin related questions.
I know. So,
okay, which olive oil can be used for skin?
I would really not be able to answer that.
Okay, all right. Yeah, so we will I'm probably sure get a skin, that. Somebody who works.
Yeah, on, you'll have to get a dermatologist.
Right. Okay, there's Bina Nayak asking, she says, very interesting session. Can the slides be shared? Bina, my answer to you is please contact Ritika directly and ask her if you really want information on that, because it's her intellectual property. So I cannot, let's not answer that here on this platform. Thank you so much for new information, learning. That was fun. Thank you very much. Very interesting, informative session. Thank you very much. Very informative session, Ritika ma'am. That's dietitian Pooja for you. Great eye opener. Oh boy, this. Sorry, I think the question jumped for some reason. Okay, yeah. So Ritika, that was for you. Great eye opener regarding olives and olive oil. Thanks for choosing this very enlightening topic. Thank you, ma'am, for an informative session. I'm just reading out, there are so many thank you, and everybody is saying very informative session. Madhu Sharma, Ankita Bhargav, Priya Gupta, Divya, Megha Taneja, Bhumika Panwar. Okay, so here's a question from Megha Taneja. It's a great way to learn about olive oil. Sorry, I thought that was a question. No, it isn't. Okay. Archana Nazre says, very informative session. Can you please share the session? Okay, well, I think I already answered that. Ritika, looks like a lot of people are after your slides.
I would really request all of you, especially as dietitians, please go onto the site which I've mentioned, the International Council of Olives, and you will get a lot of information on that.
Oh, wonderful, beautiful session. Yummy and nutritious dishes. Thank you very much. Soup and salad were very inviting. Okay, Saroj, so nice to see you here. I have to put this. Saroj Bala, I'm so happy to see you in the as one of the viewers. Saroj, thank you very much for being here. And she says, so nice. For those of you who don't know Saroj Bala, she's a very, very senior dietitian. And so is Molly, so is Gauri Priya, so is Madhu. I mean, very senior dietitians in the audience, and I'm so flattered.
They've all been so they're all the teachers in ideas. So we call they're the mams of ideas, right? So.
Well, they're very, very senior dietitians, and it's so heartening and so flattering that all of you are attending the session. Thank you so much for being here. Very informative session. Thank you, Ritika. Kalpana Shah, Ravindra Gupta, you made olives more. Okay, that's really nice. Ravindra Gupta says, you made olives more interesting, ma'am. It was a wonderful session. I think that's
a
lovely comment.
Really
okay, so where did that go? Yeah, which oil? Yeah, this is a question here from Sri Jaiswal. Which oil is good, filtered or refined oil? I don't know whether she's particularly asking about olive oil or some other oil.
So see, basically, whenever an oil says a refined oil, it means it's undergone the processing which uses the chemical and the thermal processing. That's how the term refining is used. And so that's how ideally when we that's how we've started using the word as cold compress and extra virgin and all. And we really need to be careful on the temperature of oil, because now we know from our research and all, the moment you start heating the oils at a very high temperature, the nutritive value would be completely different from what you get to see on your textbooks, right? So therefore, obviously, it's not good to have a refined oil, but I think the availability in the market is only of refined oil.
That's true.
Okay, that's great. Last two, a couple of people have asked, Ritika, if you can share the site, name of the website, because they said the slide is not very clear.
So as I said, it's the International Olive Council, which is the main headquarters in Madrid. So the moment you type the International Olive Councils, you'll get to know about that. And also there was one of the question which talked about the review paper. So I have the review paper. I will just say it is Olive Oil and Prevention of Chronic Diseases, Summary of the International Conference 2018. So if you could just type that, you would get the review paper. And it's a very good review paper which talks about the various human researches and olive oil benefits.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Ritika. And I'm going to end with this comment from Dharani Krishnan, again, a very senior dietitian and one of the pillars of Nutrition Nectar. Thank you, Dharani. She says, fantastic session as always. Thank you so much for attending. And with this, I think we have overshot the time by 10 minutes. It always happens, I think, because there are so many questions and so many, you know, interesting discussions taking place. So thank you once again, Ritika and Neeti, for coming on the show and for answering all the questions, for sharing your knowledge. You both of you are a wealth of knowledge. You've shared your knowledge. Thank you so much. And thank you to all the viewers for your support and for your attendance at the Nutrition Nectar session. See you again in probably a fortnight or so. We'll be back again with another session. So see you soon. Till then, stay safe and thank you all once again. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much for having me. And it was actually a pleasure and I had a lovely time. Thank you so much. And Neeti, your recipes were great and I'm going to try some of them today.
Thank you, Ritika. Thank you so much.
Yeah, bye-bye. Bye.